So Sasha was for a number of years in the Hamburg synchrotron. EMBL, Hamburg, Desi synchrotron.
And not a couple of years. 9 years. Not more than 10 years, yeah.
And now he's at ESRF.
Great. Last 11
Sasha,
years.
Sasha, please. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, let's go back to data collection. Yeah. So I will talk about some software tools which we will use tomorrow. Yeah. But, okay, let's go. Okay. Let's start with some maybe more or less trivial stuff. Simply remember why it's so complicated to collect data from macromolecular crystals. Yeah, why we should use so expensive and complicated equipment. Yeah, and here you see I make some list of this reason. So, and the first point, of course, it's because we have quite large cell parameter, and our detector should be adequate to resolve spot which produce so from so big parameter. Then our crystal consists of mostly very light atoms. Half of the atoms on protein it's a hydrogen. Yeah, so it's only one electron. And if you're using, for example, one angstrom wavelength, less than 1% of X-ray which coming through the crystal produce diffraction. So 99% is simply for nothing. So we need synchrotron, we need very intense beam to have some statistic, to measure something. Which then usually we have quite bad crystal compared with sodium chloride, for example. Yeah, and as an indicator of quality of the crystal, we usually can use so-called B factor. Yeah, it's some kind of measure how well our crystal is constructed. Okay. And then what is important also understand background intensity which coming from crystal itself is usually bigger than diffraction intensity, and you will see it. And the last one, which is very very important, of course, it's radiation damage. It's why we using usually cryotemperature for data collection to reduce the effect of this radiation damage. Look for this picture. It's when we start to this is trypsin. Each of this blue point represented individual reflection. This is intensity, this is quadratic resolution. You see, and each of this spot represent some individual HKL. If you will average intensity, we will have this so-called Wilson curve, this red one, and you see how big range of intensity we have. So if we would like to measure from very low resolution up to, this is about 1.5 angstrom resolution, the difference is about 5 or 6 order of value in the intensity. So our detector should provide so big difference. In the same time, we should measure very weak and very strong intensity. And look for this black curve. This black curve is represent the background intensity. So, and you see here the most of diffraction intensity is weaker than background intensity. Okay, this is old picture because this green line is showed for CCD detector. When we reading CCD detector, usually we have some additional noise which coming from detector itself. Now we have Pilatus, which is have zero. This black line should be a little bit go down, and we have much better situation. Why the Pilatus is so good detector? Because we really can increase ability to measure very weak reflection. This is part of the three-dimensional fragment of diffraction. You see, this is background, so big. And this is most of the reflection, which is compared with background, much, much weaker. And it's very simple to calculate what the kind of error we will have when we measure our intensity. It's simply square root from the sum of peak intensity plus background intensity. Okay, we can now make some kind of plot to characterize how well signal we have. It's usually signal to noise ratio. And for example, if our intensity, let's say 1000, we can, for 1 second, we can obtain signal to noise ratio about 32. Yeah, if we will recalculate it, this is 3%, yeah. So if we have intensity of background which equal to intensity of our peak, we will reduce already not from 32, we will come for 25. And so on. Then bigger background, then worse noise ratio we have. Then to improve this, of course, we can collect it longer and longer, and so on. Okay, but if I would like to improve my statistic and I would like to collect longer, I have this global damage. So it's in the beginning I have very nice diffraction picture, but as long as I'm collected my data, the picture started to weaker, and first of all the high resolution disappeared. Yeah, this is quite known effect. Oh, just a moment. And we can describe this global damage, so-called global damage, using some mathematical description. Yeah? So, like, intensity will be disappeared like scale, and it will depend how absorption dose is. And also, there is the member of the in the equation which describe this feature of radiation damage, because the high resolution disappears much faster than low resolution. Okay, and we can find some simple mathematical description, like B factor increase as a linear function, and the scale factor decrease as a quadratic function. And possible to find some coefficient which is more or less applicable for all protein for when we're using the cryo temperature, which can describe the behavior of radiation damage. Of course, if we clever and we would like to in for future analyze our structure, we also need to take in account possible site-specific damages, which already happened with very low dose. This is dose, yeah. We can collect our data usually up to 30 megagray, and after 30 megagray our crystal completely destroyed. Yeah, but we also need to take in account possible influence of radiation damage effect for our structure when the density will be disappeared due to some atoms go out from density. Okay. Again, what happened with the statistic when we combine long data collection with radiation damage? If you don't have any radiation damage, and we measure something, yeah, our statistic, our signal to noise ratio will be like showed in this curve, no damage, yeah. So we increase exposure time, and our statistic improve up to the some instrumental limit, yeah. But if we have radiation damage, after some point, intensity will be disappeared. So, and we will have some absolute limit, which we can't overcome because we have this effect of destruction of our crystal. Okay? So now, if you will combine all this knowledge, yeah, we can calculate what will happen with our limit of resolution when we will increase exposure time or when during our data collection. Okay? So if I use, for example, for this particular not very good protein, if I will collect data using low dose, I will, of course, have a very bad resolution. But I will increase exposure time and can come to resolution about 3 angstrom. Why I'm showed simply this type of curve, it's important to understand for future. Okay. That's not all story, because also we have crystal size, yeah, or crystal volume. And the statistic or intensity which we measure depends from how many materials we have. Yeah? So then crystal bigger, then more strong diffraction is. And opposite situation with radiation damage. Then crystal smaller, we need to apply more and more dose to the crystal to have the same statistic. Yeah? So, but we need to keep in mind. So if I have crystal and I can obtain signal to noise ratio, let's say N, if I will increase amount of volume, let's say in K time, the improvement in peak to sigma will be as a square root. It's very, very simple relationship. So, okay, and now, again, we can look for the behavior, what kind of resolution I can achieve if I will start to change the crystal size. Yeah, this is, we are talking now about full data set. So this is example for insulin crystal. It's usually a very good crystal with B factor, let's say 16 angstrom. So if I have crystal 150 micron, I can collect data up to 1.23 angstrom. If my size of crystal will be 5 micron, maximum which I can obtain from my crystal will be 2.2 angstrom. And this is curve showed ratio between intensity final stage of data collection to the beginning of data collection, which equal 0.5. You see here as a function dose here, and here is a resolution. So, and what we can do, if you will talk about this curve which I'm showed before, it was to when we would like to collect 100% of completeness, yeah? Okay, but what we can do, if we will have very small crystal, we can collect not full data set, but only partial data set, let's say. And in this case, especially for very small crystal, I can win a lot. So if I would like collect data to have 100% of completeness, in this case, for 1 micron crystal, it's quite good crystal, maximum what I can achieve will be 3.5 angstrom. But if I will reduce my demand for 1 degree, which provide about 4% of completeness, I'm already can obtain a little bit worse than 2 angstrom, and so on. And here the crystal size, so, and there is some limit. It doesn't matter after some limit how big my crystal, I already can't improve statistic, I can't improve resolution, and what I can do only if I will improve quality of my crystal, because it's exponential function, and so on. Okay, looks not so easy. What we can do, so this is some idea of multi-crystal data collection appeared from this, yeah, you understand? Because if you will start to look for very, very small crystal, yeah, what kind of resolution we can achieve, and this is amount of crystal which is needed. You see here, for example, number of cryocooled crystal of given size required to achieve data set resolution 1.5 angstrom, this is black one, or 2 angstrom. So if I will have the crystal about 1 micron size, yeah, to achieve this resolution, I need to have about 10,000 crystals. Yeah. So this is kind of combination. It's not so linear because we have background and so on, but potentially, we can ever estimate if we have a particular size of the crystal and with a particular quality, how many crystal and what kind of resolution we can obtain. Okay. So now this is kind of theoretical part. Now let's go for instruments which we have. Yeah, you now it's we have some kind of mixture. If you come or tomorrow we will use MX Cube 3. It's a new software program which we start to use, but it's available only in 2 beam lines. But in 4 beam lines, we still use MX Cube 2. And here the citation where you can find the manual, all stuff which I will show, is mainly for MX Cube 2, of course. Yeah, but we will do the same for next generation of program, of course, soon. Okay. So this is quite trivial, how we can organize our data collection, what is need to fill, it's how many images, what the started angle, what the exposure time, and so on. It's not so complicated, of course. But what I would like to say, if you will take into account everything what I'm try to explain, this is example how important to select proper beam size. You see, if we have small crystal, let's say 5 micron, and if we select the size of our beam which correspond to the size of this small crystal, again, I can achieve resolution 2.2 angstrom. But if I will use 30 micron beam, the maximum which I can obtain from the crystal will be 3.1 angstrom. So it's important because in most of our beam line you can specify the aperture or size of the beam, you can improve statistic in this case. We provide, because it's important to know the size of our crystal and to pass this information to the program, we provide the instrument when we optically can measure crystal size. If you can recognize crystal, you can start a pop-up window and measure size and angle and so on. Simply keep in mind there is this kind of instrument when you start data collection. Okay. Of course, everybody before start data collection, we propose to make so-called characterization. What means characterization? It's drawn on this flow. So we collect a few initial images, usually separated for 90 degrees, yeah, two or four, and then it's automatical pipeline when Mosfilm in labeled indexing these initial images. If it's indexing successfully, it's integrate reflection inside these images, and then pass this information to a program which called BEST. This program produce finally optimal plan of data collection. What means optimal plan of data collection? So take all this information, radiation damage, crystal size, flux of our beam, so it's automatically determine maximum resolution achievable from this particular crystal, yeah, and produce and give the value of exposure or absorption and so on, so complete condition for data collection. And here you can select some options to regulate according to the task of your data collection what you would like to get. Okay. So usually when you start this characterization, you determine only few parameters, but if you going more deeply before start characterization, you can regulate your demand for a plan of data collection. For example, you can say, I would like collect my data with some limit dose. If you have some specific task, for example, you collect sulfosat, yeah, and usually for sulfosat, it's better to use the dose not more than 2 megagray. So you can determine the limit of the dose, and the strategy will be calculated inside this your demand. Yeah? Or if you have some geometrical limitation, yeah, you can't see the you have something, I don't know, for example, very big loop, very small crystal, and when you rotate for 90 degrees, it's exactly will be not very good condition because the background will be very big. Yeah, so you can determine the range of oscillation which you really would like to have, and so on. You can look more carefully. Yeah, and tomorrow we will practice and understand more deeply what we can do. Okay, from time to time we have situation when the diffraction is quite anisotropic. Yeah, for example, you have one of the parameters which is much bigger than other parameter. Or look for this curve. This curve showed relative intensity as a function of rotation angle. You see here, this is row showed the full range which provide 100% of completeness our data. And what's the situation during the rotation of our crystal? Here we started, let's say relative intensity will be 0.5, and here in this angle relative intensity already 3. So obvious, here we can collect longer, and here we can collect faster to have more or less equal intensity in reciprocal space. So what we can do, we can ask strategy program to provide complex data collection plan. So if you will say, I would like to have complex data collection plan, the BEST will give a plan which consists of here in this case four different wages. And this will give much better final distribution of statistic in the reciprocal space, and you will have a much better structure model finally. Okay. Also is important say, there is the options if you would like to collect not normal but sad data, so measure anomalies difference, you should say I would like to optimize the sad data, because the target of optimization for normal data collection, where we would like to reach as high as possible resolution, or if we would like to have the best possible SAT data, it will be different, yeah? So, and you can say we would like to measure SAT, and the strategy in this case will be different. Okay, what? So also important, because radiation damage depends how big your crystal is, also important measure your crystal and provide information about, it's quite primitive, but it's only two values. It's a maximum and minimum vertical size of our crystal. And in this case, program, when it calculate future radiation damage, it will take an account, and this is angle when we have the minimum and when we have maximum size of our crystal. And program will take an account the behavior of your crystal, and of course, strategy prediction will be more adequate of reality. Okay. Finally, if you have successfully, if your crystal successfully indexing and strategy calculated, you can look for the result, and from time to time you have this kind of message. Your crystal diffract better than you believe, and please recollect these initial images, and if you would like, of course, yeah. Why we need to recollect these images? Because this strategy program, it needs some empirical information, which can be extracted only if we put the detector for really proper distance. So, and here also, before start data collection, maybe you can look for this picture which shows, this is Wilson plot, this is kind of distribution dependence, how big your rotation range should be to provide complete data set and so on. Maybe before started data collection, also not bad to look for these pictures. Okay. You also can find much more information inside this output. Yeah, for example, one of this information, this output from BEST, it's a log file, where it's prediction of future statistic, which you will have if you will follow the advice of plan predicted by BEST, and you can see here, is it okay for you, or you would like to make some modification, and so on. Okay. Today it's quite popular start to be options which call helical data collection when we have big crystal and small beam. Yeah, now in synchrotron it's quite easily to get very small beam, and during data collection we not only rotate our crystal, but we also translate crystal. Yeah, and what the main advantage from this method, because we distribute dose more or less homogeneically around our crystal. If we collect crystal without any translation, usually in the beginning we have zero dose, in the end we have maximum dose, let's say 30 megagray. If it's low symmetrical crystal, it means we have some kind of mixture between structures, because the first reflection it's present one structure, but because we introduce some local changing, but when we finish our data collection, it's already a little bit different structure. And this is especially important when we create this sulfosat measurement, for example. Yeah? But when we translate our crystal, this dose around the reciprocal space is more or less equal, more or less the same for all reflection. And this is very important if you would like to solve structure using anomalous dispersion method. So this is why it's so so popular, this helical collection, and you can easily organize it. So it's there is a description. You need to center it in one point, then the second point, and then the program will find the line of translation, which will be apply when we start data collection. Yeah, but this is many people used, but we also have the options which call helical characterization. What it means? This is very, very useful. For example, you have so big crystal, so and you start this options helical characterization, program will ask you to centering your crystal optically in one point, then they will simply, you should follow the advices of program, then they will ask you to center the second point, to find the second point, and also here there is option, do X-ray refinement of this point. So if you will say yes, true, after you determine optically these two points, program will make some cross 0 degree, then rotate for 90 degree, and using X-ray, they will refine position of this point. Yeah, and then it will go for the next point and do the same for the second point. When after the, it will be successful, program will come in the middle of the crystal, and strategy will be determined already taking account the full length of your crystal. Okay, so we can also try tomorrow this instrument. Okay, so we have a lot of some advanced method, yeah, and we will also look tomorrow what it means, yeah. And one of the method, of course, it's now for most of the synchrotron, this is X-ray centering. So we determine the area where we would like to make search of our crystal. Yeah, and now it's very, very quick. We can do this mesh screening, and program will determine automatically present the all diffraction. But what is new here, we recently developed new program which called MeshBest, which not only estimate intensity in each of this mesh screen point, but also try to recognize, is it neighbor pixel belongs to the same crystal, or it's a different crystal already, yeah? Or, additionally, is maybe there is superposition of second several crystal. When you make projection in loop, you maybe have situation when several crystal produce diffraction. So, and this is result of this screening you see here. This is one crystal, and this is additional area where weak crystal was detected here. Okay, so this is, yeah, okay, it's some idea how it works. I will not go for big details. Okay, so you see here, it's a recognized area which belongs to the different crystal inside the loops. Okay, so this is example. For example, the, it's a big crystal with a small something, and if you will make analysis, yeah, it's say here we have second crystal. Okay, this is one more example when we can This is here in loop was several membrane protein crystal. We have this heat map, and program automatically recognize the position of different map, and now we can come to where we have this diffraction and select different aperture according to the estimation of the size to improve the signal to noise ratio, and apply some cluster analysis, we can obtain this kind of electron density map. Okay. So it's additional example when we have mixture of many, many crystal. We have picture like this, you see, and program find on the border of this, we still have some diffraction from individual crystal, but in the middle, everything is gray. It means it's a superposition of diffraction and this ugly looking diffraction picture. Okay, so everybody was so tired. So additionally, we have several options, like most of our beamline equipped by Kappa goniometer, and we can change the orientation of our crystal to, in the situation when we have very big cell parameter, it's from time to time, it's very important to proper oriented our crystal, or we can also use so-called we can do this reorientation using X-ray diffraction images, or we can do it using the visual reorientation. Also, we can try to use it tomorrow. Okay. Okay, this is simply energy scan. It's everybody knows how to do it, maybe. So, and what the also we can propose, you know, we you can collect data also in room temperature, and we have some special device which called humidifier. It's a device which provide possibility to control humidity during data collection, and there is the workflow where humidity is changed, and the program automatically looking, maybe will be some improvement of diffraction according to it's, it works not very oftenly, this kind of improvement, but if you have big cell parameter, yeah, why not try to look for better condition and improve resolution, improving the quality of your crystal, because it's completely automatic. Yeah, this is one of the example which was done. Also, if you hesitated about how fast your crystal destroy, yeah, what your sensitivity of your crystal, also you can organize inside the one of the workflow automatically can organize to you measurement of how sensitive your crystal to the radiation damage. Yeah, if you have many crystal, very important project, you can spend, you sacrifice one of the crystal to measure of sensitivity, radiation sensitivity of your crystal, and there is special routine which can help you. And this is your example of plot which produces how change the B factor, how change scale, and how change the total intensity according to the increase of the total dose. Okay, new routine also, it's very, very fast, during 1 minute, using Dazor program, and also workflow, you can do this kind of study. It's without any indexing, so it's possible to apply this routine for very bad crystal, simply to estimate also how fast the diffraction will be disappeared according to the dose value. Okay, and the last slides which I would like to show, it's a relatively new workflow which called mesh and collect. Yeah, if you have many small crystal, you can fish this crystal in the flat loop and make mesh screening, X-ray mesh screening. Program will automatically recognize the position of your crystal inside the loop, and then will come to each of the crystal and collect small range of oscillation. Depends from situation, but as a default, it's plus minus 5 degrees. Yeah, it's everything is automatic. And if you have many crystal, let's say 30, 40 crystal in the loop, it will collect all this partial data set, then automatically start clustering analysis, and as a result, maybe you will have some model already. So it's useful when you have a very small crystal. Okay, I will skip it. And additionally, we can provide this program which allowed us to select best set of partial data, yeah, using the cluster analysis. So, and this is example how important if we merge many data sets, the density looks like this, but if you will select really more or less isomorphic data, you can see this sulfide is quite clearly can be seen on the density. Okay, thank you for your attention. It's everybody already so tired. Yeah. So, okay, question.
It's really, really fascinating. Even this last is great. And we have time for a few questions for those awake. Rick.
Rick,
a student should also ask questions. Don't be shy. After first Rick and then student. You first.
How much time it takes for mesh scan? Let's say you have 100 dots.
Mesh scan is very, very quick now. It depends from goniometer. For new beamline, like 23.2 or 30B, it's really 1 second. It's like, it's a new electronics, and they use so-called zigzag. So it's going like this, and they immediately go in the opposite direction, then go down, and then go again, and so on. And it depends from the detector already. So if you can collect 26 images per second, it will be limit. Yeah, so mechanically it's not limited now. Yeah, for Eiger detector you can do, I don't know, 200 images per second. Yeah, it's extremely fast. We only now start to recognize the Pilatus detector. It's a new era of data collection. Yeah, really, because we now can use X-ray like as a real instrument to searching of crystal, to characterize our size of our crystal, and so on. It's absolutely new possibility. And plus, the detector which not give any noise. This is very, very important, what I tried to say in the beginning.
Rick.
This radiation damage is also dependent on the intensity of the beam.
No. The cryo temperature, not. In the cryo temperature, nobody. So. Okay, if you go for femtosecond, which is, why people collect data from in the free electron laser? Yeah? Because it's idea diffraction before destruction. Right. Yeah? So, but this is when you get images during 10 femtosecond, for example, yeah. 30 femtosecond is already too long, yeah. Unfortunately, on synchrotron, we can't achieve this speed, but there is the plan. Potentially, we already, you know, after upgrade, ID-29 will be completely reconstructed, and it will be beamlined, dedicated for multi-crystal or for serial crystallography, it's better to say. Yeah, and one of the idea to use Chopper. Chopper, it's an instrument which allowed to control the time structure of the bunch which coming to you, yeah? So, okay, if inside the synchrotron the electron distribute equally, you can take the pulse during, let's say, 1 nanosecond, for example. Not femtosecond, but nanoseconds, yeah. But nevertheless, but in the room temperature, there is this dependence. Yeah, what your question. In the cryo temperature, nobody can show there is a dependence from intensity, but in the room temperature, it's a different story. It's room temperature, it's much more complicated radiation damage behavior compared with the cryo temperature. It depends from the solvent contents, it depends from, several stuff. Yeah.
You said that the maximum dose is limited to certain.
Yeah, maximum dose usually it's 30 megagray, yes, which you can apply. Yeah. This is dose, it's not intensity.
Yeah, okay, that's
intensity, it means number of pulse per second. Yeah, the dose is amount, yes, of pulse which was absorbed by our crystal. It's a, let's say, joule per kilogram. Yeah, it's a gray, this value, yeah, which is calculated. Ask question, or tomorrow.
Bigger beam.
Yes.
And you have a microscopic beam. So is there a difference? Like, why would anybody use a bigger beam?
Why? If you have big crystal,
yes, very important.
It's a good question. Yeah, it's not so. It depends from task, of course. Yeah, if you would like to. You see, 5 years ago, I ever say, you need to use beam which is correspond to the crystal size. Yeah. Now it's not so true because we have the Pilatus detector. Yeah. Why? Okay, you will have the same statistical result if you organize properly your data collection plan using big beam or small beam. It's more or less the same, yeah, because you will, for example, using this helical data collection, using different position of crystal, depends from the particular situation. But potentially, when you use beam which corresponds to the crystal size, crystal looks, works like lens, you see, and produce more homogeneical, better result. It's empirical fact, yeah? Then if you change many times the position of the small beam. But now, if we start to talk about this distribution of radiation damage inside our crystal, it's better to use small beam and change position many, many times. But it's not so easy to organize proper motion, because if you have needle, it's easy, yeah. Mm-hmm. But if you have some funny shape of crystal, this is three-dimensional, yeah, it's not so simple. It's not so simple to use full volume, because our purpose extract as much as possible information from our crystal, yeah. So using small beam, you need to, yeah. We now working on this, yeah. It's not so direct.
So does that mean when you do the helical scan, you have to then scale the data sets together for the different positions?
Potentially, yes. Yeah, potentially, yes. And it's, you see, it's also, if you have big crystal, but it's not homogenical. If you use big beam, beam together with crystal average all data automatically. But if you start to use small beam and change the position, for example, in the beginning you have good diffracted part of crystal, then you come to the crack. Yeah, and you collect part of the data which is for much, much worse. And then you try to merge everything. And crystal, when we radiate all volume, it's automatically you have quite good, because it's not only let's say statistic, but also for when we already started to look for the model, it's also depends the way how you collect your data, how was isotropy of the crystal, and so on. Yeah, each time. You need to think. You can maybe study. And now the Pilatus provide, and this new mechanic and electronic provide possibility to study of our crystal. Yeah.
And then there are some cofactors which get added to radiation damage faster. Is there a way that we can find it out? Like
sorry.
Certain cofactors or certain molecules,
yeah,
can get that's reported to show radiation damage faster than the normal proteins, peptides and all that. So is there a way that we can see that these are getting radiation damage?
You can see. I'm trying to show, if you have several crystals, maybe you can study simply radiation damage, because this is process, and we provide the ability, special routine, which help you to study how fast happened radiation
so he
damage.
Wants to know, are there certain molecules that get damaged more than others?
You mean scavengers, but scavengers usually works more or less in the room temperature. Variation usually happen in room temperature. In the cryo temperature, behavior most of protein is very similar. It's very, very similar. Because in the room temperature, the water play much more role. Of course, radiation damage, it's still not completely understandable. If you have some heavy metal inside, radiation damage will happen faster. But what important and what problem from time to time, it's very complicated to calculate dose, because if you have some really too much sulfur inside, absorption will be higher. Or environment around the crystal, it's also maybe important. Yeah, it's not so straightforward. But empirically, we can do it empirically, yeah. Grow crystals, yeah. Yeah,
Sasha,
we need to stop.
Thank Sasha very much for this. I would say for all of the speakers and all of the questions were really good. So what we're going to do now is walk over to the Pellatron. It used to be a Van de Graaff generator, but as I said, it was decommissioned, so it's safe to sit at the top. The view is spectacular. So we will walk over, maybe together, make sure it's off in that direction. About 5-minute walk.